I feel terrible that it's been since 2012, but my two daughters are sitting in the back, and they were born in 2007 and 2010, and I'm sure that had something to do with it. So I did bring my whole family today, and a special guest, Paul Anastas, who's also a professor at Yale. And Paul and I work together, and we teach together, and we do research together. And when I was leaving the house this morning and we were figuring out the day, I said, you should come because this is what we do and how we present. So Paul also is at Yale. He's a chemist in the chemistry department and then has a lot of experience in Washington, D.C. He was head of research at EPA for the Obama administration. And so if you have policy questions or any questions of what's going on in D.C. now, we can get into those as well. And in fact, Paul not only is the father of our two daughters, but he is the father of the field of green chemistry. So it is perfectly right for him to be here. So I'm going to talk a little bit, and then I'm going to hand it over to Paul, and he'll talk some, and then I hope we have a discussion. I'm sure you're all here because you have lots of questions about the topic. So the place that I like to start when we think about these issues is, how do we spend our time and our money when we talk about environmental issues? And to a first approximation, about 95% of the time and resources spent in this field is spent on studying the problem. How bad is it? What chemicals are out there? How much carbon dioxide is there in the atmosphere? What are the impacts of those chemicals and carbon dioxide being out there? And only about 5% gets spent on what is the solution? How are we going to address these problems? So, just to give you some context of how absurd we are and how we think about chemistry and chemicals in the environment now, I'm going to talk to you first about absurdity then. So when we think about things that we look back in the past and we say, that is crazy, it is absurd, how did people live like that or think society, think that was an okay thing, right? We can talk about women's suffrage. You can look at magazine ads suggesting, doctors telling you that you should be smoking, and in fact you should smoke Camels because they're the best. We could go back and look at medical care and talk about leaching, which is actually having a resurgence, interestingly enough. The idea that the world was flat and that these ships would actually just sail off, right? This is absurd when we think back about the state of science and the state of society, and we laugh. Now, even the idea that maybe the sun wasn't the center of the universe and it was the earth. So if we take that frame of mind and we apply it to today, what is absurd now? What will people in the future, 100 years, 200 years from now, look back and say, how did they think that was okay from a scientific perspective or from a social perspective? So just to give you a couple of examples. So I'll start with natural gas. We consume about 767 billion cubic meters of natural gas in the United States, and about 20% of that is flared. Those are those flames that you see. So we pull this natural gas up out of the ground, and about 20% of it we burn on site because we don't have the infrastructure to capture it and use it. If we want to talk about water, which is an area I spend a lot of time on, in the United States, we flush about 2.3 billion gallons of drinking water per day. Again, to give you context for that, that's enough water to meet the drinking water demands for all of Africa on a daily basis. It's just what we flush down the toilet. And remember, what we use is purified to meet EPA drinking water standards. Absurd. If we talk about energy production in this country, about 40% of global energy production comes from coal, and about 40% of that is used to produce fertilizer to grow our food. So these are absurd systems. We're setting up systems that are inherently unsustainable, that we know are polluting, that are causing damage. Here's another absurd statistic for you. There'll be a little over 1 megaton of fish in the ocean by 2050. And there'll be also about a little over 1 megaton of plastic in the ocean by 2050. So to me, this is the leaching of today, right? This is the Earth being at the center of the universe. You could talk about China building the equivalent of 30 New York cities in the past 10 years. So think about Manhattan. And then China built 30 equivalent of Manhattan in terms of buildings and infrastructure. And about 8% of all the greenhouse gas emissions in the world comes from cement production. So as China continues to grow and other economies come online to develop and build cities and urbanize, all of the concrete that we're producing is contributing to our climate change issues. Okay, and then there are approximately 150 Florida panthers remaining in the world. And the reason for this is partly over 90% of the male panther sperm are abnormal. And in fact, many of them are completely sterile from the chemicals they've been exposed to in the environment. So our use of pharmaceuticals and the way we use them and the way they are flushed winds up exposing these animals out in the environment, and they are feeling the effects of that. And so we're losing species, again, from our chemical production. And then my last kind of absurdity. In 2015, the US government did a study, the Center for Disease Control. They collected samples from a wide swath of the American population and found 287 different synthetic chemicals that are found in the umbilical cord of newborns. And of these, 180 of them are known to cause cancer, 208 are known to cause developmental problems, and several have been banned since the 1970s. So this tells us, even from a policy perspective of trying to address this, when the policy is implemented and we ban a chemical from use from commerce, many of these contaminants are legacies and still out in the environment today, and so are still cause for concern despite the fact that we have a policy solution for them. So a lot of this is a result of unintended consequences. We make chemicals because we want function in society, right? You want a pink color on the wall, you need a glue, you need energy to transport your car, to move your stuff. And so we are really interested in the function that those chemicals are providing, and often don't think about these unintended consequences of that infrastructure, of those chemicals, of those materials. When we begin to think about how are we going to address these, if we want to achieve a planet that's healthier, we don't want to harm society with our behaviors, we try to do the right thing. So there's been a lot of movement in the last 20 years of, we understand this causes a problem, we want to try to do better, but we often wind up doing the right thing in the wrong way. And so I'm going to give you an example of that. In 2007, the United States passed the Energy Security Act, and they mandated the use of renewable fuels. And they went one step further to mandate the use of corn to produce ethanol to meet that renewable fuel standard. So I will ask you, I have now said I'm going to start using corn to make fuel. What do I need if I want to grow corn? How do I grow corn? Okay, fertilizer, yes, right? I just told you how much energy it takes to make fertilizer. Pesticides that we put on the land that we know run off and wind up in drinking water. We use lots of water to grow this. So now we have water quality issues as well as water quantity issues. I need land. What happens when I start putting more value on corn is people convert either other agriculture they were doing to corn, so I'm making more monoculture, or I am now tilling land that wasn't used for agriculture and releasing more carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. The last thing, when people really started to study this, was it actually takes more energy to grow this corn and make ethanol than I get out of burning that ethanol in my engine. So we just spent maybe 30 seconds or a minute. You guys just rattled this off. The US Congress passed this bill mandating that this is how we were going to address energy security and climate change. Okay, so are these unintended consequences or these things that are not known? Clearly there's other actors in the system. All right, here's another example for you. So this is a tanker car of chlorine gas driving past, anybody recognize that building in the background? It's the US Capitol building. So this tanker car goes past, I know it looks like an old photograph, this tanker car actually goes past the US Capitol building 3 times a week to this day. Does anybody know where this tanker car of chlorine gas is heading? It is heading to the Blue Plains drinking water treatment plant because we use chlorine gas to disinfect our drinking water so that you're not exposed to bacteria and viruses in your drinking water. Does anybody know what the original patent for chlorine gas was? Why was this chemical discovered and patented? Yeah, it's a chemical warfare agent. So now think about this. We take a chemical warfare agent, we put it in a tanker car, we drive it through the most precious, in some ways, streets of our nation's capital, and we're sending it to use it to disinfect our drinking water. We know that this causes problems when we use it for drinking water, that there are unintended consequences in terms of byproducts that form that we know are carcinogens. You can ask questions about accidents or terrorism or vulnerability to risk of doing it this way. So the right thing is to provide safe drinking water for people, but is this the right way to provide safe drinking water? And I'll give you one more example of thinking about these doing the right things in the wrong way. So very quickly, what is this a picture of? So this person, so this person is spraying pesticides potentially on the landscape. I'm assuming this is food that is being grown, and so we're trying to protect these plants so we can get higher yields. You can ask questions about this chemical. Is it safe? Is it toxic? Is he wearing the right protective gear as an individual to be exposed? What happens to this pesticide when the wind blows? Where does it land? If it stays on the ground and it rains, where does it run off to? And what are the long-term effects? And we've played this story out many, many times about pesticides and chemicals that are unsafe and that are persistent in the environment, bioaccumulate in our bodies in that newborn umbilical cord, and are toxic to people and to ecosystems. And so again, we need to provide food. There is a need as the population continues to grow, but is this the right way to achieve that necessary goal? So Paul and I often argue this is how we go about solving environmental problems, right? So this is whack-a-mole. And this is the game that we play. I have a water issue. I'm gonna whack that mole and I'm gonna use a toxic chemical, chlorine gas, to do it, and I whack that mole and I'm surprised when something else comes up about exposure down line, or I think about going after my climate change issue by using corn-based ethanol and I'm surprised about the water and energy issues that crop up. And so if we keep playing this game, we can't win. And so we need to think really differently about how we approach environmental problems and our chemicals. So I'll give you one New Yorker cartoon that you will never forget to go with our whack-a-mole game. So this guy is sitting here and he feels like he needs some more space and he pushes on that wall. What's gonna happen? Yeah. So often this is what it looks like. So if I wanna solve this problem, I think I'm doing a really good thing and then it comes back and gets me sometime later on in the future. And so if I go about solving my chemicals problem by just pushing on that wall, I create these legacy unintended consequences that I need to deal with. And it's not just us, it's not just people who are suffering, right? It's the panthers, it's all of those animals and fish in the ocean. So we need a new way of doing things, right? We need innovation. So the idea a lot that you hear about, especially around chemicals, is, well, I'll just substitute. I'll find the next thing on the shelf that I can use and I'll substitute for what I have. There's two problems with that. One is, just because something is on the shelf doesn't mean it's better than what I'm using today, and I don't often have a lot of data about it. And the other thing is, we don't have everything we need on the shelf right now. And so if we don't create new chemicals, new solutions, new policies, new ways of doing things, we are never going to realize a more sustainable society. So I have given you the dark and depressing side of this, and I'm going to turn it over to Paul to help you think or imagine the world that he and I are working to create and live in.
So the nice part of this is that we often take turns, and one of us has to lead people into the abyss, and the other one gets to bring you out to the mountaintop. And this is, I've got the long straw here, so I get to tell you that everything that Julie just described is not the way it has to be. Things don't have to be that way, and there's ways to change that. And what we're going to spend, I think, the rest of the time talking about is how we go about changing that. So I'm going to ask you to, just for a second, imagine what might be possible. Imagine that if manufacturing of high-value new chemicals didn't rely on carcinogens, and instead use things like simple sugars and carbohydrates. Imagine that, that's possible. Imagine that you had these high-value materials that were not made from these feedstocks that persist and bioaccumulate in your bodies and go up the food chain, but instead of being related to these petroleum fossil-based feedstocks, which 95-97% of all synthetic materials are based on petroleum. Instead, they were based on renewable feedstocks that could be harvested or grown. Imagine that our energy systems were renewable and healthful and degradable rather than toxic and depleting and degrading. Imagine that even water purification, instead of depending on chemical warfare agents like Julie mentioned, but instead were based on things like plant matter and waste from the seafood industry. And imagine that we could get all of the function of a product without having the product need to exist itself. Imagine that's possible. Imagine that we actually turn to really the only true teacher, mentor that we have, nature, for informing our designs. And lastly, imagine where the material basis of our society and our economy were conducive to life, were benign for human health and the environment, rather than being toxic. Now, most importantly, imagine that you're not imagining. Because for the rest of this presentation, we're going to be talking about the fact that everything that I just asked you to imagine is a reality that we can do today, that we know how to do today, that the discoveries and recent years have demonstrated, not just in a laboratory, not just in a flask, but at scale. And many commercialized products. We're going to talk about a few of these. So for instance, when we use the phrase green chemistry, it's a very simple definition. It's how you go about designing the molecular basis of everything that we see, touch, and feel so that it's not going to use or generate hazardous substances. So if I asked you, please name something in this room that's not a chemical. I'd expect you to pause for a really long time and say nothing. Maybe somebody would say heat, light, spirit, wisdom. I don't know. But everything that we see, touch, and feel is a chemical. And so when we're talking about green chemistry, we're not talking about some isolated department in a university. We're not talking about one sector or a chemical sector. We're talking about the study of all matter and all of its transformations. It's about as fundamental as you can get. So green chemistry is really looking at the fundamental basis of things. And we often, if I say the word chemical to you, somebody just shout out, what's the first word that comes to your mind? If I say chemical?
Pollution.
Pollution, thank you, yes. Pollution, give me another one.
Poison,
yeah, we're on track. This is it. Usually I hear toxic, explosive, yes. Okay, now you're talking about some of the uses. But so this idea of green chemistry, the idea that you can get all of the things that we know are beneficial, like medicines and other things that we'll discuss, without all of that toxicity, explosions, fear. We talk about risk. And risk is simply how hazardous something is and whether or not we're exposed to it and how much. That's what risk is. It's a calculation that's done. And the way that we have dealt with risk in the past is by trying to control our exposure to it. If I held up a glass of a clear liquid and I said, this clear liquid will kill you instantly, and that's the only information that I gave you, what's the only option that you can do? Run away. Because I haven't told you whether, how it's going to get to you or anything else. Just run away. And basically, that's the way that we've dealt with our, you know, fear of the consequences of chemicals, is by protecting ourselves. So we have the funny suits and things like that. So we try to control the use scenarios. We try to control exposure. We regulate how you have to handle these things, how you have to treat them as they go out of the smokestack or they go out of the water pipe. And maybe sometimes we'll require personal protective gear. And all of these approaches have two things in common. One, they are always, well, since they are a probability function, they will work perfectly well right up until they don't. So smokestack scrubbers will break down, gloves, respirators will go through, and then your risk goes to its maximum. So they can, and as a probability function, will fail at some point. The second thing they all have in common is they're all going to be costly. There's no way that any of these things are going to add performance to a product. The efficiency, they're always going to be a cost drain. That's why when people talk about environmental technologies, people hold on to their wallets, because they're always thinking that it's going to be costly. Now, the green chemistry approach is dealing with the inherent nature of the substances. How do we change the molecular design so that it's inherently incapable of manifesting toxicity or hazard? How do we reduce its ability to be breathed in, to get to the atmosphere, the stratosphere? How do we make it so that it's inherently incapable of exploding or bursting into flames? We know how to do that through molecular design. Now, I often used to say the dirty little secret about green chemistry, and Julie corrected me, it's the clean little secret about green chemistry. At the same time as you're reducing all of those hazards and all of those concerns, at the same time, you are able to impart new performance, new cost efficiencies, manufacturing efficiencies. So people ask me, and they think I'm joking, when they say, how did you come up with this term green chemistry? And I say, well, you know, it's true, green conjures up images of the environment, But here in the US, it's also the color of our money. So how do you meet environmental goals and health goals and economic goals simultaneously? How do you blend those two things? And so a number of years ago, this was laid out in a set of principles. Could go through all of them, but if I were to go through all of them, at the end of it, you'd say, wow, that's really just a lot of common sense. And the truth is, common sense just hasn't been historically that common. But these are design principles. So Julie made the important point that this is all about invention, design, innovation, thinking differently. And when we come back to some of those questions about can you imagine a world where, here we have one example where instead of designing chemicals from these petroleum feedstocks that persist and build up in fish, this is a class of chemicals that is in just about every shampoo, every cleaner, every just about if you walk through the middle 15 aisles of any Walmart, these are called surfactants, and they are in there. They're things that that are ubiquitous and hazardous. But yet we were able to design things using algae, slapping on a sugar onto a fat, and making something. So instead of thinking about things like, oh, we'll try and use this carcinogen and use just a little of it, and then hopefully the workers won't be confined. No. Instead, you're manufacturing things using materials that can be sprinkled on your cereal in the morning. So this is something that actually turned into be the basis of a company that was spun out of Yale and is now located in Naugatuck called P2 Science. And is there anything else we need to say about this one? No? We're good? Okay. All right. But it's not just the sugars and the fats. The when we look at how we go to more renewable... Oh, more than happy to.
So I just wanted clarification that what technology you're sharing on the right-hand side,
yes,
is extracted from algae, or is it modified from something that's extracted from algae?
So the lipid part, this fat part, is extracted from algae. We get sugars from a variety of sources, that all different types of sugars. You click those together, and you have this these surfactants. And the nice thing is, instead of persisting in the environment, they biodegrade. So you don't have to worry that these products that, for instance, these shampoos and different cleansers, they spend 30 seconds in their use phase as you're washing your hair or something, and immediately rinsed off and wind up in the environment. So designing for after useful life is over is absolutely essential and historically almost never done. When we take a look at this crazy molecule that looks like, we like to call it trimethyl chicken wire. it looks like a lot of chicken wire. It's actually what you find in every woody plant, every tree. It's called lignin. And so lignin is an amazingly valuable product that has, because of all of these rings, that makes it amazingly valuable. The only other place you can get those kind of ring structures is out of petroleum, out of oil. So if you want to do it renewably, you're going to have to get it from wood scraps and wood pulp. There's only one problem. 98% of all lignin is burned. Pulp and paper plants are swimming in the stuff, and they're burning it for its energy value, the equivalent of $65 a ton. So if you could break this stuff down selectively and get these little rings, instead you're selling these molecules for $200 a pound. Right? So flavors, fragrances, perfumes, additives, medicines, all of these things, they're so valuable. And instead you go bio-based rather than petroleum and hazardous substances. Now, this is really Julie's work. You should say a few words about it, I would suggest.
Sure. So we think about how do we get oil that we want to use in our cars. And so you've got petroleum and the petroleum feedstock and the gas tank that you, you know, the gasoline station you're used to going to and filling up that. And if we want to get oil from a different source, we need some way of extracting it. We talked about corn-based ethanol and why that isn't a good idea. There's a big push on using algae, which doesn't require land, which you can grow on marginal landscapes that take CO2 out of the atmosphere. So we take this algae, we grow this algae and then are able to actually extract the oil out of it using carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide that's in the atmosphere that we're worried about, we can actually take that carbon dioxide and use it by putting it at a really high temperature and pressure, make a solvent out of it, and extract the oil out of the algae. So now not only do I have avoided the petroleum-based system, I'm able to actually use a renewable feedstock that doesn't compete with food, I'm not worried about land, and I'm not using toxic chemicals to do it, I'm using carbon dioxide. Yeah? So you have two options. You can actually go to the grocery store right now and buy algae oil for cooking oil, which is much healthier than corn and all these other oils because of omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. Or we turn it into biodiesel and you can replace diesel in the gas tank using what came from algae. Yeah.
The next one is right out of your labs.
Okay, and then here's another one. So this is another area of research that my group spends a lot of time on. We're really interested in taking waste materials and figuring out how to get value out of them. One of the biggest waste streams in the world is actually this material called chitin, which is, if you think about shrimp shells or crab shells, that plastic that you peel off to eat the meat that's inside. So this is just like any other plastic that you're familiar with, but it's a bio-based plastic. By manipulating this plastic, we create these little beads. They look like Tic Tacs, and they're actually incredibly efficient and effective at removing heavy metals like lead and chromium and arsenic from drinking water. We can take these beads, take those metals off, put them back in the water system, and reuse this for drinking water treatment. So there's some really nice value about this, and you can think about this just like your Brita filter, those cartridges that you buy to replace, except we're really focused specifically on getting metals out of the water.
So I said something earlier that might have sounded a little crazy, and that was imagine a world where you get all of the function of a product without the product having to exist. So we know that dyes are some of the most toxic chemistry around. To make this stuff is uses lots of hazardous chemicals, generates lots of hazardous waste, really nasty carcinogens. That's why virtually no dye manufacturing is done in the United States anymore. And it's been exported, so it's gone away. Yeah, but the only problem is away has gone away. You know, so it might be over in India and China, but people are suffering when they're doing these operations there. So we know the history of these toxic dyes. So I'd like to ask you a question. How many dyes are used in these peacock feathers? How many pigments? How many dyes?
None.
So you might say, oh, because they're natural. No, that's not the only reason. Because the peacock feather, many butterflies, many of our most colorful things in nature don't get the performance of color, the function of color by pigments or dyes. They get it through the bending, the refraction of light, the material itself, the morphology, the geometric structure of the molecules bending the light in order to get the appearance of color. So you might say, oh, well, I don't think this is a brilliant enough hue. Well, you'll have to take that up with the peacock, because I happen to think it's just wonderful. Maybe we can go to the next one. So this is a gecko. Now, I have to tell you a little story. A while back, I was redoing a bathroom. And I don't know if anybody has done this, but when you're retiling and you have to get all the grout there to put on the tiles, and oh, you're scraping and you're cutting up your nails and oh, it's just awful. And then, right as you're frustrated, you look at the big tub of grout and it says, use in a well-ventilated area. Because if you don't, it will be bad. And then you regain consciousness afterwards, you come to, and you realize, that's not how nature gets the performance of adhesion. That's not how nature gets its glues. So this gecko, if it were here right now, it could be walking along the ceiling, picking up its foot, putting it back down, adhering right along the ceiling. Now, the question for you is, what adhesive, what grout is it putting on its feet in order to stick itself to the ceiling? None, right? It doesn't get its performance in this way. It gets it through millions of submicron keratin fibers, creating these weak force interactions, this surface tension, so that it can stick on the ceiling. Now, does it have to get a spackle knife to get its foot up so that it can take its next step? No, it doesn't. It can pick it up, put it back down, pick it up, put it back down. Why do I make a point of that? Why do I draw that out so much? Because does anybody want to say that that is inferior performance? Does anybody want to suggest that that's not as good as the adhesives and the glues that we make? I'd say that that's superior performance, right? And yet, for 30, 40, 50 years, we've been hearing those green, environmentally friendly products, they don't work quite as well and they cost a lot more. Green chemistry is belying that myth every day. Now, I have to say that it's all fine that the gecko can do this, but what good does that do us? Well, when you learn from the gecko, you're able to invent something called gecko tape. And that was produced, and so has all of those performance characteristics using the lessons from the gecko. Now, that is very different from saying, we're going to harvest all of the geckos for their feet and turn it into tape. No, as a former EPA official, I object. This is learning the lessons, and that's the concept of biomimicry, and that's what biomimicry is all about. Because one of the questions that we get so often is, can you name a company? Can you name a product? Can you name an institution that's doing sustainability very well, systematically? And we always say, no, we really can't. They say, well, then that says it all, doesn't it? I say, not really, because what I can do is I can look out the window. And I can look out the window at nature, and we are surrounded by lessons, by design frameworks, by design rules that tells us exactly how to go about designing our products, our processes, our systems, our feedstocks, our energy flows, so that they are more sustainable and conducive to life. Now, Julie, you have to say a few words about this one, because this is, if you remember nothing else, you will remember this.
Uh-huh. All right, so this is one of my favorite examples of biomimicry. So I'm going to show the video, and then we'll talk about it after.
Does it have sound?
It should have sound. Whether my computer has sound or not, I don't know. I don't. That's okay. So this guy is giving a TED talk talking about this octopus. And so some underwater sea divers are diving and they look and see what they think is a kelp plant. And they spooked an octopus and he inked them and swam away. And he's gonna go find somewhere else to hide and wait 1 second. He's settling in, and
we'll see it in slow motion.
So if I'm Department of Defense, I am super interested in how the octopus is able to do this and provide camouflage in real time. So if you think that Mother Nature, how do you always say? Mother Nature is better than us, is better than we are at designing, and this idea of finding inspiration, learning lessons, figuring out how to go into our labs and make our chemistry look like what nature is teaching us will push us a long way towards a more sustainable world.
Yeah, and I'd just add, nature is better than us at design. What you just saw from that octopus involved no computer graphics. That was real. You know, that's not like the Marvel Universe. That actually happens, right? We can't even come close to doing that. We cannot come close. That is mimicking the texture, the color. Each cell is being connected to neural inputs. The octopus doesn't have just one brain. It has many distributed brains. The ability to do that, and what more importantly, what we are capable of learning from it, is probably going to be one of the most important tools in our toolbox if we want to move towards sustainable products and processes.
All right, so I just have a couple more things and then I want to open this up for discussion. So we would argue we don't need to imagine this world. We're creating this world every day and we're seeing companies and products and examples of this happening. But it is in a context and a framework that we need to be aware of. So if you start looking at the newspapers and the headlines, you'll see headlines like this all the time, right? We have to recall baby bibs because they have lead in them. China's worried about the toothpaste. There's formaldehyde, which is a carcinogen in your clothing. Bisphenol A, which is an endocrine disruptor, which means it mimics hormones and is causing all kinds of developmental effects, are found in those cash register receipts that you're getting all the time. Parents are worried about baby bottles, even these shopping bags that we get, these reusable ones. There was a big recall because they had lead in them, right? And you could go on and on and on and on and on and on about these headlines. And so people who are not well-versed in chemistry, in science, have the reaction that you had. When I hear the word chemical, I hear the word poison. And that's being reinforced in the media all the time. And when you see this, there's two reactions. One is, why is industry trying to kill me? And why isn't government protecting me from these things from happening? To the point that my mom, when I mentioned I had my two daughters, who's not a scientist and is living in this world, was really worried when they were born and wanted to make sure that we were doing right by them, went out and bought this product. So this is sunscreen from Burt's Bees, this chemical company. And this on the package is great. My mom's so excited because it's chemical-free sunscreen with hemp seed oil. So you can laugh, and we got her to laugh after a little bit of explaining why this was funny. But if hemp seed oil isn't a chemical, what is it? And how is Burt's Bees helping us overcome this fear of this idea that chemicals are toxic and poisonous? If they're telling you, buy our product because it's chemical free, it must be safe for you. And so despite all the great work and the advances, there is still a lot of work to do on communicating science, on providing science literacy so that products like this are helpful to our cause. And let them talk about the positive attributes rather than the fact that this is a chemical-free product. So I'm going to end on that anecdote and then just put up a last slide, and then Paul and I are happy to hang out and answer some questions if you have them. So I mentioned our two daughters back there. The oldest one is named Kennedy, our younger one, Akinna, and Kennedy is named after really the Kennedy family and all of the inspiration that they really provided when we think about the moonshot and what they were trying to do around society. And this is probably my favorite quote. Some see things as they are and ask why. I dream of things that never were and ask why not. And so we like to challenge our students and whoever we're speaking to really ask the why not question. Why not do it this way? Why not have the world that we asked you to imagine? What's preventing it, and how do we overcome those challenges? So with that, we will stop, and we're happy to answer any questions you might have. Yeah, hi.
Hi. So if you had to pick one best example of a product or company that developed something using principles of green chemistry, what would it be?
I couldn't. I really couldn't. So more than any individual example that I could give, what is far more, I'm sorry?
I don't think that's making any difference.
It's not to, it's just for the camera, yeah. More than any individual example, what's more astounding is the breadth of applicability of green chemistry. So back when President Clinton was in office, he put in place something called the Presidential Green Chemistry Challenge Awards. And those give out awards for commercialized products, and they give out a number of them every year. What's astounding is that if I were to tell you that green chemistry was applicable to everything from energy to agriculture to plastics to pharmaceuticals, you know, you would probably look at me askance, and that would be a pretty bold statement. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that it already has been applied to all of those areas. So virtually every industry sector has been touched by that. So could I give you the example of how we make ibuprofen in ways that used to generate, you know, a literal ton of waste for every pound of product, and has been reinvented so that the vast majority of that waste has gone away. If I could tell you the example of a new wood preservative, where before that wood preservative was invented using green chemistry principles, wood preservation accounted for better than 90% of all of the arsenic in commerce in the United States. And with that one invention, 90% of it went away out of commerce. So I could give a lot of examples like that. I'd refer you to the Presidential Awards because it's a good database. But it's more that broad applicability that I think is really most impactful. Yeah?
That Burt's Bees commercial. Think of the term green chemistry. You have to apply that. Yeah, I'm thinking when everything got labeled fat-free at one time.
Yeah.
How is that term? Is that a registered label? How would you be able to use that term on a package that a person would be confident in? Yes, this is something. I'm reading chemicals on the package still.
Yeah.
How would a person know that means anything?
Yeah. So, no, it is not a label, it is not a copyright, it is not a trademark. It is a scientific design protocol. So there is this protocol of the 12 principles of green chemistry and the 12 principles of green engineering, but no, it's not something that would be slapped on a label. There are, at last count, 800 eco-labels around the world, to the point of meaninglessness. And so I get your point. The good news is that we happen to work with an awful lot of companies. I think the majority of the Fortune 100 companies. And there's a lot of excellent work that is being done extremely quietly when no one is actually using green chemistry as a sort of marketing, greenwashing type of thing. But why aren't they? Well, there's a couple reasons why they're not talking about it and doing it very quietly. One, if they start doing things the correct way, people are going to all of a sudden realize, hold it. You were using toxic stuff before for years and years. And so, and the second is when you raise your hand and say, hey, we're the most eco-friendly on the block, you become the target for people to say, oh, no, you're not. So the good news is there's actually a lot of good stuff happening in a wide range of different industries. The mixed news, perhaps, is that it's not as well known. If there is one weak point in the whole field of green chemistry, is that it hasn't captured the power of people's imagination, the power of story, so that people don't know what's possible and people don't know what to demand. And that communication, I think, is what's most crucial. I'll say one more thing. And so it was funny. A couple months ago, I went down to a United Nations meeting on plastics and single-use plastics and the ban of plastics. And I was supposed to give the lunch talk. And all morning, people from 100 countries were comparing their plastics ban. You know, is our plastics ban stronger than yours? We're for single-use plastics. We're for oceans plastics. And they were all talking about the ban. Remember Julie's first slide? It was more about how much time we spend on the problem and rather than on the solution. You know, I started off my lunch talk by saying, I have to tell you that plastics aren't bad. Bad plastics are bad. And what we're talking about is how do you design plastics so that they are conducive to life, they are biodegradable, they are renewable feedstocks. So I don't hate chemicals, I hate hazard. I hate adverse consequences. But if you start saying, we're gonna ban plastics, then all of a sudden your solution space, your design space becomes very small. And all of the function that you want, you know, can you use glass for something? Certainly. Can you use other kinds of reusable bags or mugs? There are solutions. But do you really want to take something that has all of the positive benefits of plastics and just write it off rather than also considering how to make plastics good? Sure. So Julie was talking about some of the things that are made from seafood waste. The one she mentioned, chitosan. That's one track. There's other types of plastics that are using different types of bio-based inputs to make plastics. So yes, there are.
Absolutely.
Well, and you see it happening. I mean, companies like Lego have now come out and said by 2030, all of their products that they sell will be bio-based plastics. So they are driving a lot of science and innovation and change because people want to get in to be a supplier for Lego. And so you see new chemistry coming up, but it does require innovation. We can't make those bricks exactly how Lego wants them yet. And so there's still science and research to do, but there is drivers in the marketplace that are pushing chemistry in new directions.
To get just slightly geeky for a second, so you put your finger exactly on it. All of this stuff came from plants, right? And then it got buried for millions of years. These beautiful, complex molecules that are in plants, you bury them for millions of years, and what happens? It strips off all of that beautiful stuff, and you have what are called the straight chain hydrocarbons. You have oil, and you have these, and that's all you have. And you know why oil refining and all of that is so dirty and so toxic? It's to be able to put back on all of those wonderful things that were stripped off over millions of years. So if instead you start with these plant-based molecules, you can take advantage of a lot of that beautiful elegance that's already there. The thing is, we have 150 years of knowing how to change raw petroleum, And this area of changing around plant matter and renewables is a little bit newer. So that's why it requires a lot of innovation and a lot of discovery. Yeah.
Yeah, please.
It's a wonderful vision, but I'm worried how you get there, and particularly economically, because industry in general is worried about costs, and they're not worried about external costs. And this is a great way of reducing the external costs of the waste and so on, but I'm not sure how you bring that into the equation. So do you need more regulation? Do you need more government support in doing this?
Go ahead, Dave. This is your.
Well, it's funny. Well, no, it's interesting because it does seem as though we have come up with this term called externalities. External to whom, right? So can anyone in this room that doesn't have persistent synthetic chemicals building up in their bodies please raise their hand? Right. Good, smart, nobody raised their hand. Why? Because all of us did. Could everybody who signed a waiver saying, it's just fine for these chemicals to come into my body, please raise your hand? Yeah, still nobody, right? So externalities, external to whom? So really what you've just described, and I agree with you that this is the reality, is industry has done a great job, I'm not picking on any particular company, just in general, of privatizing gains and socializing losses. Privatizing gains and socializing harm. And that's been the equation. Is that the equation that we want to keep? Now, I recognize exactly what you said, that how are we going to overcome these barriers given the situation we have? And the way that you do it is by making this so outrageously profitable that this green chemistry is actually more valuable, higher performance, that's why we're kind of emphasizing it's higher performance rather than lower, that you've got to, people talk about carrots and sticks, that you've got a carrot so big that you can use it as a stick. Right? And so it's so profitable, so much more economically beneficial, so much more efficient that's... So every one of those examples of the Presidential Green Chemistry Challenge Awards, none of them were put in place because of a regulation. There does not exist a single regulation, as far as I know, in the world that requires green chemistry to be used. So why is it being used all around the world now? It's because it's good for business. So do I think as a regulator, as a person who was in D.C. way too long and doing regulation, am I advocating for more regulation? No, I'm advocating for innovation.
So we can't use all the shrimp waste there is in the world because we've designed our Tic Tacs, our beads, to be reusable. Yeah? So we need some amount.
Starting material.
And then our idea is, right, because you're going to distribute these to people. Our first project was actually in West Bengal in India, looking at arsenic in the tube wells that were there in the groundwater. So you're putting these in villages. You don't want to have them have to come back and buy more material.
So how do you regenerate the beads?
You just wash it in base, so sodium hydroxide. So it's just a pH. You change the pH, the metals come off, and then you can put them back in for use. Ah, so that's a great question. You're paying attention. It's good. When we first started that project, so arsenic is used in commerce, as Paul said, 90% went for wood preservative. The other 10% and growing is gallium arsenide, which is used in semiconductors and solar cells. So we went to Intel and we said, hey, do you want to fund a drinking water project in West Bengal, India, and we'll get you a really clean feedstock of arsenic for use in your industrial processes. The idea is if you now create value around that arsenic waste, it doesn't wind up back in the water, it doesn't wind up in the land, and in fact, it becomes local economic development. I need to get out of the water for safe drinking water, and now I can sell it to somebody who's going to create a reverse supply chain into an industry sector. Yes, please.
There's another way we can drive green chemistry.
industry to be happening faster, beside the fact that right now it is economical, and that is we have a lot of power, not just by voting, which is a part of it, how we vote, but the other important thing that every one of us can do every single day is think about what we're buying. Mm. So the big mantra now is reduce, reuse, recycle. Recycle, you didn't get into, but unfortunately we've been duped there because a lot of things we think we're recycling are really not getting recycled. But the reduce part, if we, and there's starting to be a movement to buy more things used, they're already out there. And you might think when you go to the store, well, it's already on the shelf, it doesn't really matter. But the thing is, when you buy it off the shelf, then they will make more of it because they think there's a demand. When we individually stop creating the demand, and a lot of us may be grandparents, and you know how many plastic things we want to buy for our kids, and there are so many options of things we can do with them that don't involve plastic. And if we really need the plastic, try to go to a Goodwill, go to Salvation Army, go, you know, buy it used. It's already out there and it will go into the dump otherwise, which will be a problem. So we have this kind of control, we do, and we don't realize it and we don't think about it.
No, I absolutely agree with you, and it's a great point. So, I mean, you vote at the voting booth, but you vote with your wallet every day when you make these choices. And so making choices, but I think as Paul alluded to, it's really hard for consumers to know when I go into the store what is the right thing to buy, what choice do I make. And so what we talk about a lot is there's a lot of these labels out there, there's policies, but our goal is everything on that shelf is designed with green chemistry, and so there aren't bad choices. But absolutely, consumers have a huge role to play in this. Yes?
How long do you think it'll be before everything on the shelf is green chemistry? Every industry, it's boring because it's just the status quo.
I don't, Eileen, you're like.
What was the question?
How long will it take? To me, there's this huge sense of urgency, and I don't understand in some ways what the barriers are, right? Even on climate change, as we're watching Australia burn, and you know, places we've visited and animals we've seen, and the Great Barrier Reef, and right, glacier, like you look at these massive things, and those are acutely happening. We're watching them in real time, and then a lot of the stuff we talked about is actually chronic, right? The crisis of being exposed to these chemicals happens over long term, if those acute things aren't getting solved or getting attention on them, I don't know how long it will take before things that are more chronic will come online.
Tipping points are funny things. They're really tough to predict, but when you look back on them, they happen pretty quickly sometimes. So, yeah.
I was hoping for a more hopeful.
I'm sorry.
Well, I meant to say by next year.
How many students can we get? I mean, our thing is, how many students can we touch? So either by writing textbooks, by traveling to universities, the classes that we teach, right? It's the next generation who are going to go into these positions, either in Washington or in business or in the lab making these things. And if they know better, that's how it's going to happen. And that's really where I get my hope from, is just trying to educate as many people as we can as quickly as we can.
Even at science cafes.
Yes.
This might be more of a comment than a question. So about the EPA or environmental regulations or the regulations that the government does. I've been around long enough to know what environmental catastrophes can and did happen in the past, particularly in the 70s and 60s, Rachel Carson. So I wouldn't write it off completely. I think it probably should be more emphasized. I don't see that transition that you're talking about, the holy grail of chemistry coming about for all the chemicals. We are addicted to chemicals as a global society. So I think regulating and putting out the environmental analysis and where do certain toxic chemicals become biologically irrelevant, and is the technology out there analytically to be able to assess that properly. I think there should be more research in that area as well.
So thank you for asking the question, because let me clarify what I meant by I'm not calling for more regulation. I've actually always thought that regulation was half of a strategy. It's setting the floor below which you must not go. And it's, you know, this, you can't pollute more than this. You can't emit more than this. You can't allow it. And you set these regulatory floors. And the rest of it has to be dealt with through innovation, through invention, to keep on creating a race to the top, a race toward continuous improvement, is the way I always thought. I have to tell you, and the reason I thought that is because the fierce fighting against regulation means that when I was in Washington, I was cheered for getting certain, you know, reports and analyses out the door and into the public light on really toxic chemicals. And those reports had been lingering for 15, 17, and 22 years, respectively. And everybody was saying, yeah, you got them out. And I said, I'm ready to cry that it took that long. So the reason that I say I'm hesitant about regulation is because it is so hard, because people are tying things up to try and stop them from happening. And innovation can happen faster. Now, all of that said, I said it's a regulatory floor. I never anticipated that they were going to start tearing up the floorboards. What's happening right now is they're tearing up the floorboards. The basic infrastructure, the National Environmental Protection Act, NEPA, which has been about as close as you can get to sacred for 50 years, is now being proposed to be gutted. I could go on and on with a whole series of lectures about this, but I am very concerned about what's happening, and yes, regulation is very important.
So just to make an additional comment in that respect, so, you know, I'm glad you're recruiting young people to go into green chemistry, because I think that is the future, but we should also be recruiting scientists to go to Washington and become politicians and replace those that don't know what the hell they're doing.
Good, good.
I completely agree. I think there was a question right in the back.
Sorry, it's long-winded. The scope is a little big, but how do you, especially with the population and I guess increased demand for petrochemicals and stuff like that in developing nations, obviously India, China, definitely Africa, that's another massive emerging market, how do you advocate for green chemistry, which is pretty much just the same solutions when the efficacy of, like, you know, fossil fuels and stuff like that is historically a lot better than sustainable solutions? So how do you advocate?
Say that last part again.
How do you advocate for sustainable solutions over petrochemical solutions?
Because
what
you said was the sustainable solutions don't work as well as
obviously they do, but historically we had a longer history of fossil fuels working a lot more.
So I think there's two answers to that. One is we do a lot of work in those developing economies because they don't have the infrastructure. So this idea of I have to overcome the cost of that's already factories built, pipes in the ground, much easier business case to actually make when you're starting from zero, one. Two, it's higher value, and so you're growing your economy in a green way and you have a higher value product to offer. And three, the other interesting thing you see around these questions of population is as populations get to a higher quality of life, that population increase, that rate tends to come down. And so the question becomes, how do you get that higher quality of life without all of the associated harm we've caused to get there, right? So if I can realize that quality of life in these places in ways that are safe and benign and not depleting, you actually see those population rates start to decline. And so there's many drivers to actually this happening more quickly and more easily in developing economies than in places like the US, Australia. Yeah.
Yeah, and I'd say some of the most activity is happening in Asia around green chemistry, in China and India and Indonesia.
Yes.
For exactly those reasons.
Yeah. Is there any chance of, in, say, like the next 5 to 10 years, getting a label like we have on our dishwashers and all that, energy saver, something equivalent, which will move a consumer to buy those products?
I just say the European Union just put out a policy statement where they are going to put out across the European Union green chemistry, sustainable chemistry standards. So those policies are being developed now. Last month, DuPont, the new DuPont, put out their principles for the coming 10 years, coming decade, I think, right? And number two on their list of things was 100% of their products will be made using green chemistry principles. I was flabbergasted. I've waited for 25 years to see that. And so we'll see, but that's a pretty bold statement. And so do I think that things are moving? Yes.
So two things on that, too. There are also emerging standards to get listed on stock exchanges. So if you're a company that makes products and you want to get listed on that stock exchange, you have to show your products are made using green chemistry principles. And the other thing is EPA does have a label in this space. It's called Design for Environment.
Well, and Safer Choice.
And Safer Choice.
Yeah.
They haven't caught on in the same way. And I wonder if it's Well, have you not seen it? And then is it also because it's EPA, which is politically loaded in some parts of the country, right? Just because EPA is listing it doesn't mean somebody's going to want to prefer to buy that product. And so I think unlike the European Union, where the government is in the position of labeling products, in this country it's become much more from the private sector of companies labeling their products, and then it creates a very confusing marketplace.
What are your thoughts then on genetically modified plants where you can aggregate or minimize the uses of pesticides or herbicides?
So this goes back, I think, to this idea of doing the right things in the wrong way. So you can do anything in the wrong way, and certainly GMOs can be done in the wrong way. I think the question for us as a society is, can they be done in the right way? And there might be certain applications in certain places, but this question of distributing these GMOs onto agricultural fields where they can spread to neighboring fields and people are, again, not volunteering to participate in that. So do they have a role? Can I imagine in a laboratory and a fermentation tank and an enzyme that I need? Yes, but I don't think we've answered the question of how to do it in the right way by distributing them out into the environment and hoping that they don't cause lasting, persistent damage that we don't and can't predict.
Yeah, I'll just add to that. Just like I don't hate chemicals, I hate hazard, I don't hate GMOs, I hate hazard. And unless you're going to really be able to understand the GMOs well enough to answer that question, I don't think you have any business driving them into the food supply.
Yeah, sure.
Is there any place like on the internet or a book or an article that would help me and all of us figure out exactly what are the main products that exist right now that we should be changing over to?
ACS has a website called Green Chemistry Institute. They have some.
Yes, there are some lists there. There is not a good, I mean, what I think you're asking is, you know, and I think about like organic foods and there's the dirty dozen, right? If you only have a few dollars to spend on organic foods, this is where you should spend that money, right? It's not on bananas because it's the banana peel that you don't eat that has the chemical in it, but it is apples because it gets inside to the fruit. And so I haven't really seen a listing like that on products about if I'm going to just spend a limited amount of resources on green products, what are the right ones, either from a health perspective or environment perspective. But that sounds like a good project.
Sounds like a real project.
Yeah.
So two things in relation to your question. First of all, this won't tell you where to go, but it will give you a really solid background on what has been happening. And the book is called Plastic, A Toxic Love Story. And the writer, the author of that book, has immense, immense, immense background information in the book, is at the back of the book. Half the book is a bibliography and resources that she went to. It's 10 years old at this point, so much more has even happened since when she wrote it. But it really gives you a really good understanding of the things that are going on. And it's written in a very readable manner, even though it's quite scientific. The other thing is, there is an app, because I found out about this book at a course at Southern, that's in environmental studies, and there is an app that one of the students mentioned, where you can go in a store and you can scan and find out if you want to buy a particular product, which has the least toxicity and the least harm in it. I don't remember the name of it.
Yeah, it's called the Good Guide.
There is an app.
It's called the Good Guide, and it's owned now by Underwriters Laboratory.
I don't think that was the name of it.
It was an independent, and then Underwriters Laboratory bought it very recently, but you can go in and scan a UPC code from the app on any product in the store, and it will tell you what's in it and their evaluation of the toxicity of it.
There may be more than one app.
Yeah, but
there's other apps. Yeah.
I think one advantage that standard chemistry has is that it's so flexible. You can change every molecule, every atom, every bond. And I don't know if green chemistry is totally reliant on already manufactured molecules of other organisms. So you have a limited set of things you can do with green chemistry, whereas standard chemistry is infinite in its spectrum of possibilities.
Luckily, that's not the case. Yeah. So there is nothing about green chemistry that limits any transformation. Any transformation of any molecule in any way. There is nothing about hazard and toxicity that makes it more efficacious. Any transformation that you want to carry out, chemical transformation, can do using green chemistry. And be happy to have a long conversation with you about it. But luckily, there are journals. There are now probably a dozen different scientific journals from the Royal Society of Chemistry, American Chemical Society, filled to the brim with new discoveries for the past 20 years of new molecules, new manufacturing methods. So luckily, there's no limitations.